poppin' your shit, nigga.
Back in the 60s, I was known as Latin. Today, I'm known as Shek Latin. I'm an elder, a noble elder of the Nuwampian Nation. I've been around. I've been walking with Abenubiru Akatar since the 60s, when the title at that time was Abenubiru Akatar. It was back during the 8-ball days. If any of you remember the book called Behind the 8-Ball, that's the school that I come from, and also Bible interpretations. So I'm one of the few elders that's still around that can tell you step by step, year by year, about our history and the things that I saw and witnessed with my own eyes, and things that I've heard from one mouth to my ear. So I'm sharing with you some important information about a serious rift that exists that should not exist, and we're going to clear this up once and for all. You know, I'm 69 years old, and I started walking with the master teacher, Abenubiru Akatar, Dr. Malachi Z. Yorg, Panababia Noon, as he's known today, Panababia Nanan. I started walking with him back in the late 60s, 1967.
And they know, so I have a right to check me out. Because that guy there was a criminal. I don't know how he learned all the stuff he knows. I'm a right. When I got arrested, they said, "Who are you? What are you? Put that fingerprint down again so you can make sure you're from here. Where'd you come from?" Are you the same man that's been out there running around calling himself this or calling himself that? Are you the same kid that we used to know? Where'd you get all this information? How come you know everything? And some more. I'd laugh and smile. They couldn't believe that's the same guy. You know, many Sunni Muslims would say, you know, I know him. I remember him in 1965 when he came into State Street and took his Shahada. A brother Lukman gave it to him. First of all, I was in Sajin in 1965. I was in prison in 1965. I didn't get out until 1967. So you got wrong information again, Bilal Phillips and the whole Sunni Muslim world. If you're going to do something with church, get the right facts and stop making fools out of yourself.
I read my first books. I took my Shahada in 67, 68. I met him in the flesh in 1970 in Brooklyn, New York. At that time, you know, there was only two prominent doctrines out there. There was the Nation of Islam under the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the teachings of the ancient Pharaoh Amenhotep. Those are two dynamic doctrines that existed then. Nothing else existed there. So everybody was gravitating toward these two men, Amenhotep and Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Well, I'm just going to go ahead and ask you a few questions. You said you've been around since the nine ball counts, all four counts.
During the eight ball days, if any of you remember the book called Behind the Eight Ball.
Because this is a question that's commonly asked. Hold on 1 second. All right. Yeah, there's some technical difficulties. Trying to get this, make sure the sound is right. So people in the chat room, be sure to let me know if it's too loud, too low. I'm trying to make sure we're right. There was a publishing company that people were asking questions about. This publishing company was called Those Who Care. Right? Liberation Information, Those Who Care. Can you give us a background on the publishing company? Were you around in New York, in New Jersey at that time when these different things was taking place?
Oh, yes. We covered a lot of area. We not only covered New York and all the boroughs, we also covered Jersey too. But that's where we started. He was cranking out, not to mention that Nuwapo publications, which was from the 60s, the Nine Ball, Bible Interpretations, and a host of different newspapers, newsletters that he was putting out. Because remember, at that time, the Nation of Islam was the most prominent black movement in the country. But at the same time, there was a new doctrine of Wunuwa. There was a new a new group that was out that was attracting a lot of attention. It had a dynamic leader. I was there, and we went by the title of Amanubi Rakatar. Today, he's known as Dr. Malachi Ziyar or Pandabab Yananin. And that... he started publishing the Nine Ball, Bible Interpretation, different newsletters and stuff, and took New York by storm. Nobody saw him coming. It was a whole different doctrine, you know, whole different, you know, behind the Nine Ball was a whole different perspective on a black perspective group. And it took everybody by storm. He instantly became an instant celebrity, the talk of the town, so to say. Prominence, just like that, man. It's like he came out like a thief in the night, and nobody saw it coming. So at that same time, that everybody that was in the conscious community were attracted to Amanubi Rakatar, including a brother named Johnny. Afroo Oonoo, who called himself out. I knew him personally, and I've met him, and we traveled to Newark many times. He was from Newark, New Jersey. Traveled to Brooklyn. I met him in Brooklyn, but he was from Newark. And being I was traveling to Newark all the time, at least two or three times a week. He and I used to travel over there and propagate together. He was actually a student under Amanuburi Akatar. At that time, everybody that was in a conscious community was studying under Amanuburi Akatar at that time. And the numbers started growing bigger and bigger and bigger. And then in 1970, and in the early 70s, he exploded in population, popularity, and eventually our popularity superseded every black group, including the Nation of Islam in America. In terms of our doctrine, nobody had a doctrine like ours, and nobody could touch our doctrine. So a lot of, and I tell you, a lot of brothers came through and broke off. They studied on the Panabab, you know, or Amanuburi Akatar, and then they broke off and started their own groups. And this is what Afroo Oonoo had done.
Hey, yo, G, you did it again.
I've sat down with him many times and we've studied books, Bible interpretations. We rode the subways together back to Penn Station and traveled over to Jersey many times. Jersey was like my second home, we wasn't really close, but I, for a short period of time, I actually had talked with Johnny Brown, whatever, and Afroo Oonoo. So the translations that was coming here were not very good translations. They were distorted versions of the Quran.
And a lot of the black people were starting to fall under.
So the blacks in America were gravitating towards Sunni Islam.
So this is why Amanuburi Akatar stopped teaching what he was teaching to go into Islam.
Stopped teaching Islam, exactly.
So you were saying how Afroo Oonoo had broke off. So I'm guessing he broke off because what? Because he didn't want to go into the religion?
He didn't want to go into, at that point, Amanuburi Akatar was teaching Nuwapu or Unuwa in the 60s, ancient Egyptian mysteries. So at that time, the government started flooding the United States with all types of Qurans, and that was when the Pakistani and Indian immigrants, Muslims, started migrating to the United States. And they brought these bad translations of Quran. The Ahmadiyya Quran was a bad translation. The Maulana Muhammad Ali and Yusuf Ali from Pakistan were bad translations. But along with these translations came the people. New York especially. New York was flooded. The East Coast was flooded with immigrants from Pakistan, India, and different Islamic countries. So they came into New York and took over. They took over State Street Mosque. And that was a split. And that's why Fatima, or the Holy Mother Mary Abba Okran, Amanuburi Akatar's mother, left State Street Mosque. She left because it wasn't just her, but a whole Nubian congregation left with her. And that's what gave birth to her son, Amanuburi Akatar, with bringing Islam back to expressing purity. So he abandoned the teachings of Unuwa. And that's what Afroo Oonoo ran with.
Oh, so he divided.
He left. He said, I'm not going into religion. But Amanuburi Akatar decided to go into religion because that's what everybody was into at that time, all behind the eight ball. Thank you. damn nam, I ain't going to Vietnam. And speaking of Vietnam, I got drafted in the military in 1967 to go to Vietnam, and I didn't. I'm still here. I'm a miracle in itself, because that same year, 1967, 19,000 soldiers died that one year. That was the year I got drafted in. So, they were doing conscious music, you know, and they,
now these guys are G-Poo and Reepoo and all these other, these are people that was with Johnny.
Bunch of kids, man. I don't know them personally, but it sounded like a bunch of young men, a bunch of kids.